tonight, you're blessed that you're here. And because, you know, I'm just believing the Lord that every one of you be able to excel in the things of the Spirit and know how easy it is to move in interpretation of tongues.
Yes.
And know how easy it is to move in the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom and prophecy. It's very easy. Actually, when you learn how to speak out of the Spirit, out of the realm of the Spirit, the language of the Spirit is supposed to teach you how to speak out of the realms of the Spirit. And that's why the Lord gave to us this wonderful Holy Ghost flow that just kind of takes over so our head don't get in it, you know, and mess it all up. And then we learn, and some people on a slow learning curve, but hopefully tonight you just let God just take you into the steep part of that learning curve. And you just begin to just flow as you just speak. You speak by the Spirit. It isn't a mental thing anymore. People sit in the council room with me, or I meet people and they go, "Are you a mind reader?" No, I'm not a mind reader. I wasn't praying or asking God for the word of knowledge about them. All I was doing is speaking out of the realms of the Spirit, just speaking to them the things that were just right there coming to me. And what I was doing was I was telling them everything they just went through in the past 30 minutes. I was hitting right on every major highlighted point, or the last day, or the last week, or the big event of their life. And so, you know, we make the gifts of the Spirit to be different things than they are. It is the flow and ministry of the Holy Ghost that reaches in to meet the needs of people that are around us, to declare the Word of God and the working God in our lives and what Father wants to do through and to their lives. And so I want you to open up your Bibles with me in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And I'm going to highlight a couple of verses of Scripture here as I begin to try to make this really practical for you. And I hope that I can say that being in the school of the Spirit is one of the best schools to be in, because He's a great teacher. He's long-suffering. He's patient. You know, He lets you go and repeat the first grade for 50 years, if that's what you want. And He's happy. He's happy all the time. Just so happy to see you back in the classroom, kind of thing. And, you know, but the Holy Ghost wants us to go ahead and mature. He wants us to go ahead and excel. He wants us to grow. He wants us to recognize, as I was saying on Wednesday night, that we received all this power and all this ability, and as radical as we can think about it. And like I like to use, my vision of how to evangelize or how to do missions in Saudi Arabia as example. How great can you imagine, you know, the things of the Spirit and what you can do in the things of the Spirit? He wants us to be excited about that. He wants us to begin to function in an unlimited realm and begin to believe that in the absolute, you know, extreme of what is impossible, and be comfortable there, and just enjoy Him, rejoicing Him. And as we do, these things begin to explode in our life, and we begin to do things that people look at in total bewilderment. How does he do that? How does she do that? They're really smart, or they're really lucky. No, flow it in the Holy Ghost. And then the Lord just works miracles. He just works miracles. And so Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and he says in verse 5, he said, "I would that every one of you spake in tongues." Now, I want you to understand this. I want you to just look at this. I want you to get this. And I believe that this word that we translate tongues, properly known as tongues, should be translated by context, divine utterance. I would all that you speak in these divine utterance. But it's okay to say, and it's better to say, biblically, unknown tongue, because that's really literally what it means, and then that way nobody gets confused. And we know that Jesus talked about tongues. Some people don't know that Jesus talked about tongues. Does everybody know in here that Jesus talked about tongues? Huh? Jesus said, "These miracles shall follow you. These signs shall follow them that believe my name. They'll cast out devils and speak with tongues." Somebody said, "Oh, you're just going to have you're going to speak better. You're going to speak Bible scriptures instead of speaking man's opinion. You're going to speak sweet words instead of bitter words." No, that isn't a miracle. Okay, that isn't a miracle. Anybody can do that. Okay, this is a miracle language. It's a miracle language. Hallelujah. Then it goes right along. Take up serpents, drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. Lay hands on fivefold miracle ministry of any believer right there. Okay, and We know that when the Lord sent the river, when he sent the outpouring of the Holy Ghost upon his church and upon all flesh, anyone who would receive. When he says all flesh, it means these things are available for anyone who wills. Okay? He didn't pour out the Holy Ghost upon, you know, the demon-possessed guy down the street who's cursing God. No. He poured out his spirit upon all flesh, everybody who's willing to receive. So it wasn't just limited to priest and prophet and king. Okay? Just a few folks. Anyone who would receive. And when that happened, there came this language. And so Paul said, I would that every one of you spoke with tongues. Because he opens up 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and he sets a precedence, a hunger, a zeal, a passion, a determination, a state of the heart that ought to exist in every one of the people that have been born of the Spirit and have the Holy Ghost on the side of them. There's only one Holy Ghost. The same Holy Ghost that we are born of is the same Holy Ghost that wants us to step into the power of, okay? Hallelujah. So it's not two Holy Ghosts. Well, there's the Holy Ghost for salvation and the Holy Ghost for Pentecost. It's a Holy Ghost. It's one Holy Ghost. One single, one Holy Spirit, okay? And so, you know, we see the expression of this divine power and this divine glory and this utterance. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about the utterances that we go on. But Paul's saying there's, he's setting a precedence. He's saying, I want you, in the very first verse, he says, I want you to follow after divine love. That's the way you're supposed to be walking. And if you're not walking divine love, which he already laid out, you know, my goodness, if you're not walking divine love, if you're not going after that beautiful realm of the Holy Ghost, everything that you're doing is of no value, of no profit. Even faith to move mountains of no value, no profit. And how much more will tongue be as tinkling cymbals? So, and a sound of brass. So he tells us, follow the love, follow after love. But he tells us to desire, be zealous, be desperate, really, for the spiritual. And I know many translations said spiritual gifts, but it's for the spirituals, it's the realms of the Holy Ghost. Literally, the best way to translate that particular Greek word is the realms of the Holy Ghost. Be desperate, desires for realms of the Holy Ghost. And he's going to really devote, by and large, chapter 14, to just the specific utterance gifts. He's already laid the foundation in chapter 12 about all that the Holy Ghost is going to do. So we can't forget what he said in 1 Corinthians 12, 7 through 11. And he talked about all the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Huh? But he's going to talk about it here again. Now, there's something else that really to keep in mind here. You know, in this, the first thing that he highlights then is this, that when anyone speaks in an unknown tongue, he speaks not unto man, but unto God. And he's speaking mysteries in the Spirit. Who's speaking? The Spirit of the Son is speaking. The Holy Ghost is speaking. He's teaching us how to speak to God. He's speaking us how to interact with God, how to magnify God, how to declare these things of heaven. And then out of that, the Lord teaches us how to speak on his behalf. So now, keeping in mind this, I would that all of you speak with tongues. Don't forget that. He didn't say, tongues are only for some people. He didn't say that. I would that all of you speak with tongues. It's like on the day of Pentecost, there's about 120 people there, and about half of them got gifts of tongues because it was only the Lord's will for half of them to get it. No, they all. The sound of this rushing mighty wind came, filled the place, hallelujah, and tongues, clothing tongues of fire came and rest upon each one of them, and they all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Now, I'm going to talk to you more about the outflow of that and how easy it is to move in the outflow of that and how you've just got to let go and let God. Because God's just teaching you how to speak without your mind being involved, how to speak without response. I mean, I have people come and sit in front of me all the time. They ask me a question and I'll start talking to them. Something is totally irrelevant to the question that they ask. And I watch over and again. And, you know, and I've had so many times over the past 34 years, people ask me, are you a mind reader? No, I'm speaking to you by the Holy Ghost. And how am I doing that? I'm just speaking like I'm speaking in tongues. It just lets flowing right out of me, you know? I'm just telling you what's going on. It's an unction. It's an inspiration on the inside of us. And we learn how to go with the unction and inspiration. And the more we go with the unction, the more that we go with the inspiration, the deeper it becomes, the more accurate, the more regular, the more often, the more specific. Why more accurate? Because we don't stop and pause into parenthetical statements out of our own thinking. That's why more accurate. Because we just go with it. We just flow in this. It's beautiful, beautiful realm. So Paul says, I want all of you to speak with tongues. I would that all of you speak with tongues. And people have got to get that. okay? They just want to try to focus on the last couple of the last verses, you know, do all speak with tongues. A rhetorical question in the last part of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And then they want to put at the end of that, no. Well, you can say no if you want, because they hadn't come into the baptism of the Holy Ghost yet, okay? Because the baptism of the Holy Ghost is always going to result in that. Somebody said, well, there's a couple of times where the Bible preaches where they were baptized in the Holy Ghost or filled with the Spirit, and doesn't say they were specifically speaking in tongues. Well, but Ananias went and laid hands on Paul. He received a sight, and doesn't say he spoke in tongues, but we see something here, right here. Look at this, verse 18. He said, I speak in tongues more than y'all. I would that all of you speak in tongues, and I speak in tongues more than y'all. I want you to get that. Are you with me?
Yes.
I want you to get that. I would that all y'all speak with tongues, and I speak in tongues more than y'all. You got that?
Yes.
Well, when do you reckon Paul started speaking in tongues? When Ananias went and laid hands on him and he was filled with the Holy Ghost. It's just that simple. It just doesn't take a whole lot of being able. People get all excited when somebody's talking about the mark of the beast, 666, or, you know, whatever, and they got some deep insight that is not even apparent at all. You can't put any two verses of Scripture together to get what they're now telling us, you know. Now it's ISIS. I'm going to tell you, I've got a revelation. So, you know, it just goes on. It's Hitler. I mean, it's, you know, Hitlery. See, Hitlery Clinton. Okay, no, I'm not going to get into that. But they get on all of these, they get all these things, you know, all these crazy, wild-eyed things, you know. And yet the Scripture is so very, very clear, very, very plain to us that this is what happens when you baptize in the Holy Ghost, because this is where the river begins to flow. Now, if I can get you to believe that this is the river flowing, that this is a miracle act, this is the ministry of Jesus. Jesus said, these signs, these miracles to follow them that believe. Okay, it's right there in the five dimensions of the miracle ministry. And that you begin to understand that this is the flow of the river. This is the flow of divine inspiration. This divine inspiration is going to take you someplace. So if you can lock down into that, then faith is going to begin to work in your life. And then when faith beginning to work in your life in the context of God's love for you, you know, you're going to have a real release of the Holy Spirit in your life in every dimension of the miracles, signs, and wonders. So I want you, once again, I want you to get two things, two very basic things here in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. I want you to get this. He says, brethren, he said, I would that you all spoke with tongues. Okay? Just I want you to get that. Verse 5, I would that you all spake with tongues. Did you get that?
Yes.
Paul wants everyone to speak in tongues. You got that? Pretty simple. Paul says then in verse 18, and I speak in tongues more than you all. Now, what I need to help people understand is first and foremost that this gift of the Spirit is fundamental to flowing and functioning and operating in the Holy Ghost. And I could spend a lot of time talking about this from the beginning of Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. I can then take you, as I did to Paul. I can then take you, to Samaria. They had not yet received the Holy Ghost. But what happened? When Peter and John came down, they laid hands on them. They received the Holy Ghost. And we know they received the Holy Ghost just like everybody else. People want to say, I was baptized in the Holy Ghost, and they never have the evidence that they were baptized in the Holy Ghost, which is a departure from Scripture. It's like folks were going swimming, and somebody's sitting there dry, and they're telling us that they're swimming. You're dry. You didn't go swimming. Huh? It's like people out there, it's like somebody standing on the beach with their board in their hand saying that they're surfing. You're not surfing. We're surfing out here, man. What are you talking about? You can't surf on the beach standing there holding your board looking good. You got to come out here. And so, you know, this is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I want everybody to fully understand that that's what the Bible teaches. The Bible does not teach anything different than that the baptism of the Holy Ghost is accompanied with the evidence of this divine utterance. And now I want to be able to take you on and tell you what that divine utterance would work in your life, what you're supposed to be believing it's working in your life, and how to cooperate with the Holy Ghost so that these outworkings can take place in your life. Because I see people get stuck all of the time. First and foremost, I've got to lay the foundation that you know that this is a good thing. This is the promise of the Father. Okay? This is the will of the Father. These are words that are used over and again. This is the gift of God. Okay? Somebody says, it's amazing to me. Everybody wants to go back to this. Are you trying to tell me that I've got to speak with tongues, baptized in the Holy Ghost for the evidence of speaking in tongues to be saved? No. But the same Holy Ghost that saved you is the same Holy Ghost that wants to work this out working in your life. There's not two different Holy Ghosts. Same Holy Ghost, okay? Now, why is it that people are afraid of this utterance? Because men have moved in and been able to be more influential than God the Holy Ghost in His church and have produced fear. God doesn't produce fear. He produces love and confidence. So, I mean, you think about it. One of the first things Paul devotes a whole chapter of the Bible to the gift of this language, to tongues, the expression tongues. And he opens up with it saying he wants us to covet. He wants, in verse 1, he wants us to covet, be desirous, be zealous of the spiritual. And the spiritual, once again, being the realms of the Holy Ghost. Because pneumatikos is the Greek word that is used there. You could say that pneuma is the actual word for spirit, which we usually is referring to the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost. But this particular word, when we translate it spiritual, it's talking about what the Holy Ghost is doing, the outworkings of the Holy Ghost. And the outworkings of the Holy Ghost, how are the outworkings of the Holy Ghost going to be developed in our lives? Well, obviously, the outworkings of the Holy Ghost are going to be developed in our lives because we receive this divine utterance where now God, the Holy Spirit, finds free course to speak through us without our head getting involved. It's just inspiration. I want you to understand this is how the word of knowledge works. I want you to get this tonight. This is how, first of all, let me say this. It's how interpretation of tongues works. It's how the word of knowledge works. It's how the word of wisdom works. It's how the discerning of spirits work. It's how you know to move in miracles. It's how you know to move in the gifts of healing. This realm begins to hook us up and train us to begin to function and flow with the one who's moved on the inside of us. See, the Holy Ghost has moved into us. A lot of people, if I say, have you felt the Holy Ghost today? Can you distinguish the Holy Ghost from yourself? Do you know that there's two different realms? It may be spooky to people. It's wonderful to me that God's moved on the inside of me and that God has come to rule over my spirit if I will let Him rule over my spirit. Are you listening to me? Yeah. I want to make this very practical to you because God, this is how the church was born. The Holy Ghost came upon the church, baptized them in His glory. They were all gathered together. You can go and read that in chapter 1. In one place, in one accord. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind and filled the place where they were gathered. And clothed in tongues of fire came and rested upon each one of them, and they all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Now, every time the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the promise of the Father, every time these things are mentioned, the outworking of that is tongues. Somebody wants to use two exceptions. No, you can't use two exceptions because the same outworking is there. Paul said, I speak in tongues more than you all. So I want to go back because some of you came in a little bit late. I want to go back and repeat myself on this. Paul was sitting in a place where he was blind now because of the encounter he had on the road to Damascus. Ananias is sent to tell him to receive his sight. And when Ananias laid hands on him, he received his sight and was filled with the Holy Ghost. So the scripture doesn't say he began to speak with tongues. So that's one of the places that you could say is silence. Theologically, you can't argue from silence. What we do know is verse 18 of 1 Corinthians chapter 14, he speaks in tongues more than them all. Are you okay? So anyone who cannot understand the clear conclusion that when he was filled with the Holy Ghost, he began to speak in tongues also is just really fighting the truth. They're fighting the obvious. So we don't want to fight the obvious. And fact of it is, if we're fighting the obvious and if we're arguing with the obvious, you know what's going to happen? You know what's going to happen? You know what's going to happen? If we're arguing with the obvious, it's a sign and a token that we not hungry. It's a sign and a token that we not zealous. And if you're not hungry and you're not zealous, this stuff has no bearing on you. Because Father wants us to be hungry and thirsty for the things of the kingdom of God. Anytime Jesus talked about the kingdom of God, he was relating it to the outworking of the Holy Ghost that was given to him. Every sign, wonder, miracle that Jesus did, he did by the Holy Ghost that was given to him. He said, if I work miracles among you and cast out devils by the Holy Ghost, then the kingdom of God has come to you. So the Lord says, above everything else, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. People want to go seek first the kingdom of God and they're not seeking the things of the Spirit, then they're missing the whole point of the New Testament. You're to be born of the Spirit, to live in the Spirit, to walk in the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit. You're born of the Holy Ghost, to walk in the Holy Ghost, to be led by the Holy Ghost. Come on. And this is the proof and the token that we are born of God, that we are sons of God. Now, why would we not want the outworking of God? The manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to every person. Say, the manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to every person. So then say, the whole manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to me. Do I want it? Yes. Am I willing to be trained in it? Because am I willing to be in the school of the Spirit? Oh, I'd like to be in the school of the prophets. I'd like to go be back there with Moses. I'd like to go back there, be with Elijah, Samuel. Give me a break. You're here with the Holy Ghost. Well, it's just so difficult. No, it's not. You're going to have to get full of love and then relax. You get full of love and relax, this just flows. Praise God. Hallelujah. And so Paul says something very important here that I want to help you understand, because he's going to talk about prophecy, and he's going to talk about interpretation of tongues, and he's going to talk about them in the sense to where that they're almost overlap. You don't know which one he's talking about. And in fact, I'm going to tell you, they have the exact same outworking, the same inspiration that comes with the words. Okay? Musicians can get this. Musicians, poets can get this. Artists can get this. Creatives can get this. Even though that's purely in the realms of the natural, they can get this more than the other folks. You know? And because it's a little bit more logical. You're just playing something on the piano, you're playing something on an instrument, a guitar, whatever, and all of a sudden you start hearing words. You just get this inspiration, right? Yeah. Musicians, right? Yeah. It's beautiful, eh? Poets have the same thing. You wake up in the morning, all of a sudden you go outside, you see something, it inspires you, right? It inspires you and it just starts flowing, right? Same way with the artist. There's some really good artists in this church. It's just something happens, and all of a sudden, you know, it's just like you just get this overwhelming inspiration, and you've got to get the paints out, and there it goes, and it's just beautiful, okay? Well, God the Holy Ghost gives us inspiration. Hallelujah. He gives us a flood of inspiration. Jesus referred to it as rivers of inspiration, a wellspring springing up of inspiration, and it's inspiration in things that are the inworkings of God for our lives, like love and joy and peace. So that's why Paul says, follow after love and desire the spiritual, or covet the spiritual, or be zealous about the spiritual. Okay, I want to just challenge you. Are you zealous about the spiritual? Because if you get real zealous about it, you're going to say, give me that bat. I can hit the ball too. Yeah. When is my turn? Yeah. When is my turn? I came out here to play ball. And you got me over here. Everybody's got the bat except for me. What's that? You're zealous. You're earnest. You're desirous. You're not here to just watch. Because you don't feel like you can do it. Give me that bat. Give me that ball. I'll show you how to do it. Whatever, you know. It's my turn. Don't get in around a swimming pool and don't let her swim. She's going to be, I'm telling you, man, you're going to have a fight on your hands. She's going to be talking about getting in the pool all the way there. And then when she's there, she don't have time to get her bathing suit on. She don't have it on. She's going in it what she's got on. Or she may strip off what she's got on and go in the original. Okay, because she's zealous about occupying her spot in the pool. Are you with me?
Yeah,
listen, dear people, hello. Okay, this is desire, spiritual gifts. This is zealous. I want this. Not, oh, poor me, or oh, I can't do it, or oh, there's some problem with me, or somehow I just don't have that gifting. That just doesn't, it's not even relevant. That's all out of the realms of fear. That's all out of the realms of intimidation. That's all the realms of insecurity. That's all the realms, out of the realms, when I say intimidation, fear, whatnot, I don't want to fail. I don't want to do something wrong. I don't want to upset the program. Hey, get yourself some fire in your belly.
Yeah.
Get yourself some fire in your belly, and you'll be so absent of any self-consciousness, it won't even matter. And then if the enemy comes afterwards and said, oh, you really made a fool out of yourself.
Oh, yeah.
You don't even, you learn, you get now to learn at another level how to bring your, into captivity every thought. You say, you lying spirit, leave me alone. Father, thank you for the gifts of the Spirit. I thank you that when I ask you for a piece of bread, I didn't chew on a stone tonight. I don't have broken teeth. Hallelujah. Right? I thank you, Lord, when I ask you for a fish, I didn't get a serpent, get snake bit on the tongue. You know, come on. It just, the Lord just wants us to get comfortable. God wants you to get relaxed. You can't do anything all stressed out. Oh, no, I feel something, but I don't know what to do with it. Just hang on. Now, Paul says to this, and I want you to understand this, because literally, these things just come as inspiration to just flow out of you. I do words of knowledge easily because I don't say, hey, I'm going to give you a word of knowledge. That's too much pressure. Oh, did you give us a word of knowledge? That's pressure. I'm not going to do that. I'm not a word of knowledge on command. But I'm going to tell you right now, if you ask me a question, I'm going to start speaking to you out of the Spirit, because I've learned how to speak out of the Spirit by praying in the unknown tongue. By speaking in an unknown tongue, by building up myself in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, the unknown tongue, huh? But with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost, praying in an unknown tongue, hallelujah. And I've learned how to speak out of the Spirit, and it's just a wonderful realm. It's not something I'm having to force. Just try to force speaking in the Holy Ghost. It just doesn't work. You just get relaxed, it just flows. And the more you relax and the more you get comfortable, the stronger it comes, the more powerful it comes. That's the same way with all the other giftings of the Spirit. And so Paul says in verse 6 here, he says, now, brethren, if I come to you speaking in an unknown tongue, what shall it profit you? Now, he's going to show us, as it were, several dimensions, as it were, four dimensions of interpretation of tongues. Now, you're going to get this only just a few places. This is one of them. Because I think that people dichotomize 1 Corinthians chapter 14 way too much. Okay? Because he's saying, I'm going to come to you speaking in tongues. Can you get that? Yeah. This is Paul. Paul goes into Ephesus. He finds in Acts chapter 19, and he says to the people, he finds disciples, first thing he says is what? Have you spoken in tongues yet? Are you listening to me? Yeah. Are you hearing me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Paul. First time he sees him, hey, guys, you spoke in tongues yet? That's basically what he said. He said, have you received the Holy Ghost yet? He's recognized them as believers, and he said, have you received the Holy Ghost yet? And they're more honest than modern-day Christians. I have modern-day Christians say, oh, absolutely, absolutely. Been baptized, baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost, like on the day of Pentecost. Yeah, absolutely. And then I say, let me hear your spirit pray. And they look at me like, huh? And so I know, you've never spoken in tongues yet. The divine utterance has never taken hold of your life. You've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. You've not been filled in the Holy Ghost. Are you saying I'm not saved? No, I'm not saying that you're not saved. Because I've got one good verse of scripture for you right here. Philip went down to preach Jesus in Samaria, and they were baptized in water and believed. That's what the scripture says. But none of them had received the Holy Ghost yet. Huh? Now, according to the scripture, he that believes shall be saved. Are you with me? Thus, they believed. They were saved, but they had not received the Holy Ghost yet. So Peter and John comes down, lays hands on them, they receive the Holy Ghost. They're filled with the Holy Ghost. And everybody who ever received the Holy Ghost had the evidence about us to give it a matarabidiyelavramatost. You can't change the precedence, okay? So Paul says, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said, we didn't even know that there was a Holy Ghost. He said, don't you remember what John said? I baptize you with water, but the Messiah, Christ Jesus, gonna baptize you with the Holy Ghost. So what'd he do? He laid hands on them. Who laid hands on him? Who laid hands on Paul? I want you to learn something here. There's a test at the end of the meeting. Okay? Who laid hands on Paul? Ananias. What happened to Paul when Ananias laid hands on him? He was filled with the Holy Ghost. He was filled with the Holy Ghost. So, Paul lays hands on them, they were filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Acts 19, 3 and 4. Now, why is it that people want to fight these things in God? These people say, you can't in the church, you can't be speaking in tongues unless there's an interpreter. I'm an interpreter, you can speak all you want. And then they fail to realize that there's praying in tongues and that they're singing in tongues, huh? And they're singing with the understanding, praying with the understanding. I'm telling you right now, singing with the understanding and praying with the understanding, I want you to understand, is another level of unveiling of interpretation. I want you to get this. I want you to get this here tonight, okay? I want you to, because it's the inspirations of God. I hate it when somebody tries to tell me what interpretation of tongues is and they've never done it. I do it all the time. I can tell you, I'm an expert. I've not only read it, and I've not only heard about it, I've not only seen it and witnessed it all of my life, but it happens in my life. I know how it works. I'm an expert. I can tell you about what this means because I do this. It's like somebody comes along, tells you how to give you a quadruple bypass, and they've never opened anybody up. Not even the cadaver. They not even opened the cadaver up. Are you listening to me? Are you going to let them open you up? No, I'm not going to let them tell me how to do that. I know, sir. You know, hey, Doc, I appreciate your understanding and all your classroom time, but you've never done this. Would you please bring someone else in who has done this, and then let me hear what they got to say, okay? Because I'm more interested in the practical application. At a quadruple bypass, are you more interested in the application? Hallelujah. I want the knowledge, okay? I want the information. I want it to be accurate, but I want the experience too. Are you with me? Don't let somebody tell you what interpretation tongues is, and they've never done it. And then they say, oh, you hear people all the time, because everybody's for prophecy. Everybody. It doesn't matter who they are, they for prophecy. I don't care if you're a Baptist or Episcopalian, Lutheran. Everybody's for prophecy. But guess what? When they don't have any tongues, they don't have any prophecy. Wonder why that is. Oh, you can't be speaking in tongues around here, but we're for prophecy. But they don't ever prophesy because they grieve the Holy Ghost. They're not up with, they're not flowing in the supply by which that prophecy comes. Are you listening to me? It's just a state of things. I mean, it doesn't take too much rational logic to see, look, this thing ain't going down right in the church. Not when God set precedence for the church. Not when Jesus declared. See, people don't know that Jesus talked about tongues. They don't know he ministered on tongues. He said, these miracles shall follow them that believe. In my name you'll cast out devils, speak with new tongues, take up serpents, drink any dead thing will not hurt you. Lay hands on the sick, you shall recover. Okay, so here we are. We're walking in miracle dimension. It's a miracle dimension of the Holy Ghost speaking through us. Hallelujah. So that we can do what? Speak as the oracles of God. So that we can speak out of these realms. So here Paul says, let me show you something. He speaks in tongues more than all. First of all, he said, verse 5, I would that all of you spake with tongues, right? You got that? He said, I speak in tongues with more than you all. Verse 18, everybody got that? I want you to walk out of here with that. I want you to walk out of here tonight being convinced, if you're not already, that the baptism of the Holy Ghost carries with it an evidence of the language. Are you listening to me? Yeah, they really need to be up on the front row where I can discipline them. But, you know, they actually do better up here. But that's okay. I'm taking them home with me. Okay, listen, what will this knowledge do for you? What will the Word of God do for you? If you will let it, it will bring you into the faith of it. Because no gifts of the Spirit, no activity of the Holy Ghost can work without faith. Well, then tell me, how does faith come? Because you hear the Word of God and you believe it and you do it. Yeah. Just a person who hears it, they're not doing anything. They're not justified. You have to do the Word to be justified. You have to do the right Word for it to mean anything. You have to do the Word for there to be any show of faith. That's why James said, show me your faith without your works and I'll show you my faith by my works, okay? There's got to be some kind of an outworking. Speak the Word only has got to be there, but there's got to be a value to the Word. So that's why it's so important. That's why we lay the foundation and the atmosphere for the movings of God with His Word. God has chosen the foolishness of preaching to reveal His power. He sends forth His Word, which is living, it's powerful. I want you to grab hold of this. I want you to be able tonight to walk out of here and be confident that you know how to flow in the gifts of the Spirit to interpret tongues. That I want you to understand how that it comes with the same kind of just urgent, it comes with the same urgent inspiration. But if you never learn how to let that flow, if you've never been baptized, if you've never received, if you've never heard the Word of God and believed, if somehow fear is the greatest hindrance to the flow of God in your life, to the flow of God's blessings in your life, to the activity of God in your life, fear. But listen, you're not under bondage to fear. He's given you the Spirit of the Son, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. And that's all in the context of flowing in the Holy Ghost, once again, there in Romans chapter 8. I want you to get this. I want you to be persuaded of these things tonight. I don't want you to live under the intimidation of your parents and your grandparents and your great-grandparents and all the way back to Adam. I want you to start getting a hold of what God has supplied to you through your heavenly Father, amen, and you, the first generation, praise to the Lord, what He supplied to you by the Holy Spirit. It's just a demona masi ekira na montabaya shibrebobotive de ita. It's a divada makusina. It's a divate animal. It's a divine inspiration. Hallelujah. And if I say, if I started to go romose, just for any moment of the year, any moment, any period of time, then I could easily lose or be very difficult for me to speak in English. And when I'm a sekira and a mateno, when I go back to English, it's really just about what I'm also saying when I'm about to do in the spirit. Do you understand? Yes. It's the same flow. It's not some kind of, oh, what did it, what, oh God, give me something. Give me, what should we say? And then somebody stopped and said, thus saith the Lord. I mean, you can do that, but it doesn't really flow like that. Paul rarely said, thus saith the Lord. You know what I'm saying? He usually said, hey, now this is me speaking, not God. I mean, he turned the tables on things. Yeah. See, God told Jeremiah, I put my word in your mouth. Yeah. Huh? See, other prophets, he came, the word of God was revealed unto them in a vision, in a dream. The word of God came unto them. But to Jeremiah said, I put my word in your mouth. In other words, speak. When you open your mouth, it's not going to be you speaking. I'm going to be speaking through you with inspiration. It's just going to flow out of you. It's just like, it's just coming out of you. You're saying things that you know is right, and you don't know how you know them, but you know they're right. Yeah. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Now, what does God say in the New Testament? I put my word in your mouth and in your heart. Where do you find that at? Romans chapter 10, verse. Come on. You need to know these things. Are you listening to me? He's put his word in my mouth. Can you hear me? All you need to do is learn how to get comfortable speaking by the Spirit. And isn't it wonderful how the Lord set it up for us to learn how to get comfortable speaking by the Spirit, where we're overwhelmed by this. Hallelujah. I wake up in the middle of the night. I wake up in the morning. I'm in the Karosundarinia. I'm running a race with Paul. He spoke in tongues more than them all. I want to speak more in tongues more than him. Hallelujah. Somebody said, why would you want to do that? Because I'm zealous for the spiritual. I'm hungry and thirsty for the things of God. I'm hungry and thirsty for the kingdom of God. I'm seeking first the kingdom of God. Same word, seek first the kingdom of God. Seek the spiritual. Seek it. So I said, oh, you're not supposed to be seeking the gifts. Well, that's not what Paul said. Don't seek the gifts, seek the giver. Well, that sounds really good. But you're supposed to seek the gifts and the giver. Are you listening to me? Don't start trying to change the word and all acting like you're declaring to us what is the mind and the will of the Father. Because you just took away from the word. And that ain't a good thing. Don't take away from the word. That ain't a good thing. Because if you take away from the word, you open yourself to deception. If you add to the word, you open yourself to deception. Are you listening to me? Right. Paul said, seek the spiritual. I know King James said, seek spiritual gifts, because by application, in other translations, said by application, it means spirits going after spiritual gifts, because he's talking about gifts. But it's bigger than that. Seek the realms of the spiritual, the realms of the Holy Ghost, because out of the realms of the Holy Ghost is going to be the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. There's going to be in working of the Holy Ghost, the love, the comfort, the joy, the peace. I want you to get this. Hallelujah. And there's going to be the outworking of the Holy Ghost. And you may not even know it, but what you're getting ready to say next is connected to that. Because he put his word in your mouth and it just flows out naturally. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. It's a wonderful thing. I taught Naomi how to say Papa. She can say it on demand now. Papa. I worked with her for a little while. Papa. At breakfast, a couple of mornings in a row, Papa. And it's like, Papa, right, left, and center. It's in her mouth now. Hallelujah. I say, Papa, she goes, can you give me a Papa right back? So, people, he's put his words in her mouth. Why do we make it so complicated? Why do we make it so hard? It's the most difficult thing about this is just simply cooperating with the Holy Ghost and yielding to the Holy Spirit. That's the most difficult thing. And that becomes as easy as breathing. Because he's like the breath we breathe. Hallelujah. He's the pneuma. It's like the wind. It's like the breath. Hallelujah. But he's a person, but he becomes that much a part of our being, living on the inside of us. I mean, can you begin to believe that you are the temple of the Holy Ghost? The Holy Ghost has come and dwelled on the inside of you. Jesus said he'd be with you and in you. Are you listening to me? He'd be with you. He is with you, but he shall also be in you. So people talk about how much was the disciples saved. Well, I'm sure that they were very saved. They were around Jesus, the Savior. But he said that he was telling them there's going to be something you're going to get after that I go away and I send the Holy Ghost. And that is that he's going to be in you. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
It should tweak everybody's theology a little bit what Jesus has to say. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
What Jesus has to say to me is more important than what Augustine had to say. I don't know about you, but what Jesus had to say is more important than what Luther had to say. What Jesus had to say is more important than what Calvin had to say. What Jesus has to say is more important to me than what any man has to say. He's the Word incarnated, hallelujah, in the flesh, the living Word, and he declared the Word. Amen. So I'm going to go with his Word. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. So Paul, now Brandadekirostombadeirai, says, what shall it profit you if I come speaking in tongues? And he will, because he speaks in tongues more than them all. And he also said, don't forbid anyone to speak in tongues. Did you get that?
Yes.
Those three things in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 need to be highlighted by anyone, everyone. And but you'll hear very few people highlight those things. One, verse 5, whether you all spoke a tongue. Two, verse 18, I speak in tongues more than y'all. And then also forbid at the end of the chapter, forbid no one to speak. Do not forbid anyone to speak in tongues. Huh? Are you with me? Is everybody here? Everybody listening to me? So when he came speaking, when he said, if I come speaking with tongues, it's a guarantee. But he says this too. And we know it's a guarantee that he came speaking by tongues, because that's how the church was born, in tongues. And guess what happened when, Peter, Peter's scared to death. Oh my goodness, they're going to kill us all if we go out in the streets. We're going to die just like Jesus. Thomas says, let us go with him that we may die with him. You know, they're just all dying, you know. But now, Holy Ghost, they're all hiding in the upper room. They're all hiding in there. Now the Holy Ghost comes upon them. They don't even know where they're at now. They were behind closed doors, locked, barred, you know, secured tightly, okay, praying, oh God, don't let them come get us, okay? And now they get comes upon them. They overwhelmed with the glory. They now stumble. I believe that they didn't know what they were doing, you know? Next thing they know, they find themselves out in the street. And what are they doing? What's coming out of their mouth? What's coming out of their mouth is they're declaring the wonderful works of God. They're magnifying the Lord and declaring his wonderful works. I want you to turn over there and just look at that for a second, because it's going to help me make the point that I want to make with every one of you here tonight, so that you just get all oiled up and all your parts start working properly. Amen. I want you all to get oiled up. I want you all to get baptized in the oil here tonight, okay? I want everybody to get oiled up, all parts be working good, praise God. And you're just feeling so comfortable and so cozy and so home and just, you know, being silly like you are when you're comfortable with, you know, whatever, as it were, you know. So here they are. Everybody listens. Everybody, more than 3,000 people can hear. More than 3,000 people. Listen to this. Look at this. More than 3,000 people and about, nine languages are all can hear. More than 3,000 people in about nine different languages. Are you listening to me? Can understand what 120 people are saying all at the same time. And now somebody's going to make something natural out of that? Give me a break. What is God? Hey, wire with your brain. That is a miracle, man. That is like, you know, you can't understand 120 people. Everyone's saying some simple sentence if they're saying it different. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
And now there's nine different languages or so, and more than 3,000 people. And now we have to have microphones and amplification for 30 people to hear us. You know what I'm saying? And more than 3,000 people all hear in their own language what they're saying while they're speaking in the heavenly language. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And so he says, and what do they hear? They hear them speaking in tongues, in our own tongue, the wonderful works of God. You hear that? They're magnifying the Lord. You hear him speaking wonderful works of God. Now, what happens to Peter? As now, what the Greeks and the Arabians and the Phrygians and everybody else is hearing, while he's going, basta kere mandali piera vataya, they're all hearing in their own tongue, because now God has given them, as it were, Holy Ghost miraculous translation devices. Are you with me? They're hearing him declare the wonderful works of God. They're hearing him give praise and give thanks and magnify God of all that he's done. That's what they're hearing. And he goes from spokaranadeshtapiranesha palanea to now he's going to speak by, he's going to interpret. He's going to be begin ikona. He's going to begin to speak by, he's going to begin to speak by revelation. And we're going to go back to this. Paul said, if I come speaking to you in an unknown tongue, what should it profit you lest I speak by revelation, by prophecy, by knowledge, or by doctrine? That's going to be the outworking of the tongues. Are you listening to me? Yes. Hallelujah. Can you hear me? Yes. So what is takara mon jiri shala mandeya? And then all get silent. Everybody got silent. Get silent. Then all of a sudden we hear Thomas go, this is that which was spoken. Think not that we had drunk, seeing as about the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. No one had ever in the history of Judaism had put that verse of scripture outside of the context of the millennial reign of Christ. Christ, the Messiah, would have had to set up his kingdom, be reigning on earth for Joel to be what Joel prophesied to be being fulfilled. And now here comes somebody for the first time ever out of this realm of Adakarashindalabokoya, now giving revelation and saying, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. Now he's not only speaking by revelation, he's also speaking by the knowledge of the Holy Ghost, and he's also speaking doctrine. All at the same time, he's establishing, where does this fit? This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass in the last day, saith God, I pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And he's now saying, this is that. This is what is going on right here. This is what you're seeing. And when they thought of is what they were seeing. Because he says in verse 33, he says, Jesus being exalted to the right hand of the Father and having poured out, having received the promise of the Father, has poured out that which you see and hear. And what were they seeing and hearing? People staggering around like drunken men, that they had to say, wait a minute, this is but the third hour of the day. They're not drunk as you suppose. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. What were that's what they were seeing. What were they hearing? Now, there's a very important link in Acts 2:33, because now that is the promise of the Father that Jesus told them to go wait in Luke chapter 24, verse 48, until they received it. Now, but being exalted to the right hand of the Father, verse 33, now links back also John chapter 7, verse 38 and 39. Jesus said, come to drink, come to me and I'll give you to drink. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for he was not yet glorified. Jesus now being glorified and exalted by the right hand of the Father, and having received the promise of the Father, has poured forth that which you see and hear. So every verse of Scripture of the promise of the Father, of the gift of God, of the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, of being endued with power from on high, or receiving the ministry of Jesus, which is to baptize in the Holy Ghost and fire, which is his heavenly ministry, is all linked together at that pivotal verse of Scripture in Acts 2:33. Can you see that? Can you understand that? And that's all about what they were doing when all of a sudden there suddenly came a sound from heaven, and the whole place that they were sitting in, that whole upper room, that realm, was saturated by the manifest glory of God the Holy Ghost. And it was first as a wind, and second as clothing, tongues of fire came to rest upon each one of them. Now, what is happening? Jesus said, I'm going to send you the Holy Ghost. Are you with me?
Yes.
That's the moment the Holy Ghost was sent. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Can you teach that? I hope you understand it. I hope you read your Bible lesson so that you understand it. That's the day that the Holy Ghost came. That's the day that the teacher came. Now, what was the teacher going to do when he came? He was going to lead us and guide us into all truth. Hallelujah. He was going to take everything that belongs to the Father, and he was going to reveal it to us, transmit it to us. Amen. Amen. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
These are just verses, all the Bible of God, all the Word of God, all the things that Jesus said in John 14, 15, 16, all converging at this moment. All the things that John the Baptist said about Jesus baptizing in the Holy Ghost. What's the last thing Jesus said about himself? He said in Acts 1, 5, he says, John baptized with water, but you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. Okay, Are you with me?
Yes.
What did John say about Jesus' ministry? John said, he's the one who baptizes you with the Holy Ghost and fire. I baptize you with water. He baptizes you with the Holy Ghost and fire. See, the last thing Jesus said about his ministry, you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. Not many days from now, they were seated there in the upper room. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven that filled the whole place that they were seated in. And then, clothed in tongues of fire, came and rested upon each one of them. They all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. So what is that? Promise of the Father. It is being endued with power from on high. It is being baptized in the Holy Ghost. It is receiving the gift of God. It is the place in which rivers begin to flow out of their innermost being, which was not yet available because he was not yet glorified. It is the receiving of the Holy Ghost. I will send the Holy Ghost. He wasn't there yet for men to receive. It is the moment in time, as Prophet Joel said. What did Prophet Joel say? I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. What's going to happen when I pour out my spirit upon all flesh? Well, what God caused him to understand and what he declared is everybody will prophesy. Well, what did everybody begin to do? Now, that's the utterances of the Holy Spirit. Now, out of that now becomes all of these other divine utterances that begin to function and flow under the same kind of inspiration that you become very comfortable with, that you become empowered with, that you become strengthened in, because you give yourself, as Jude said, build yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Now, when you get finished with Acts, when you get finished with 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter 14, you cannot make any mistake about what Paul said or what Paul meant or what the New Testament meant about praying in the Holy Ghost. Praying in the Holy Ghost is the utterances of the language of the Spirit. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
But it is also the utterances that will excel out of that, because tongues are supposed to excel. And I want you to get this. So Paul says, go back with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And, you know, once again, the word is going forth here today. I don't want to have to try to wrestle with people, because I'm going to tell you right now, you can't have this even if I wrestled you down and intellectually caused you to believe. Okay, you can't have this till you get hungry. You got to want this more than anything else. You got to want this more than all the other stuff you go seeking after, your clothes, your reputation, your money, your house, whatever, okay? This is going to have to be more desired by you than anything else, okay? And then you can have these things because they're very precious. They're very sacred. See, God, the Holy Ghost, his name is sacred by name, okay? Holy means sacred. Are you listening to me, okay? So, but I want you to hear the word. I want you to be convinced of the word, because you don't want to believe or do or be a part of anything that is not clearly 100% the Word of God. But when you've got the Word of God validated with proofs that stack to the heavens, what? You have no excuse. You just be hard in your heart and not believe. Why? Because you were raised differently, you know? And we watch as you know, people in China, formerly Buddhists, formerly atheists, people in Nepal, formerly Hindus, people also in Africa, other places. As soon as the ministry of the Holy Ghost comes, they immediately get baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. They begin to speak with other tongues before you even know that they're saved, because there's no hindrance. There's no religion. There's no other doctrine that says that they can't have this. It just happens. You don't even hardly have to even say anything about it. This the power of God comes upon them. It's just like they're there. It's like, well, we didn't even teach on baptism of the Holy Ghost yet. You already baptized in the Holy Ghost, because it just, there is no religion, false things, lies, doctrines of men. They hinder fear. They hinder what God would do, freely give to people. So we don't want you to be hindered. We don't want you to believe anything. We don't want you to know yourself after the flesh. We want you to know yourself after the Spirit. We don't want you to know yourself based upon who you believe you are. We want you to know yourself based upon who God said you are. We don't want you to know yourself based upon who your parent, what your parents made when they brought their genetics together in you. We want you to know what you were made in Christ Jesus when you were born of the Spirit and washed with the water of regeneration. I mean, talk about a gene change. Amen. That's pretty powerful. So Paul says, what should it profit you except I just also speak, okay, by revelation, by knowledge, by prophecy, or by doctrine? And he says this. He says it because he goes in and he says, so because everything that has a sound, whether it's a pipe or a harp, except it give a definition of the sound. How shall it be known what is piped or what is harped? So he's telling us that tongues has for its ultimate end an expression of value are things that can be understood by the same miracle means of speaking. Now, somebody's saying, isn't tongues an interpretation a distinct gift from the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge? Absolutely it is. It just functions so much alike, it's hard to tell the difference. That's what I'm trying to help you understand. Is it unique from prophecy? Is the interpretation of tongues unique from prophecy? Yeah, I mean, I'll tell you why. Because prophecy can just come to me, and it does many times, without any tongues being spoken. But then there is a something that is absolutely identical to it, but the inspiration came from the tongues. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Do you understand what I just said to you? Should I say it again? Where, and you, in this church, you get to watch it happen all the time, because we are continually doing what people would call writing songs. And all they are is the interpretation of tongues. Somebody begin to sing in the Spirit. Somebody begin to sing by the Holy Ghost, sing in tongues. Because what Paul called singing in tongues, he called it his equivalent. He called it singing in the Spirit. So that's why I say, he said desire the spiritual, because it's the outworking of the Spirit. Then that spiritual that produces all of this manifestation of which tongues, prophecy, revelation, interpretation of tongues is all a part, according to what we're looking at here. Chapter 14. If we were looking in chapter 12, it would also then include miracles, gifts of healing, discerning of spirits, working of faith. Those also would be included in them. So I want you to understand that this is an inspiration realm that is really a big part of like worshiping. If I can get people to worship, if I can get people to just praise the Lord and just love on Him. Because see, Father's really, He desires Not sacrifices and not offerings. The kind of sacrifice and kind of offering that Father wants, He's not interested as much in everybody's tithes and money and whatnot, although it is a part of worship, don't get me wrong. But what Father is most interested in, Jesus highlighted it in John chapter 2. He's looking for those who will worship Him in the Holy Ghost and in truth. And so, in fact, the only worship that the Lord is even going to be receiving is the worship that comes by the Holy Ghost. Now see, the church doesn't realize this, but because they've become so steeped in the liturgy and tradition. The Lord spoke to me and said, church is not about singing and preaching. He told me very clearly, church is, and which you can prove in the Word of God, church is about flowing in the Holy Ghost that produces singing and preaching. Well, we just want to sing our little songs that we've been singing over and over again. And when many people are singing songs that people actually wrote, smoking dope and drinking booze. And so that song goes, draw near to me, God, because I'm so far away from you kind of song. You know, on and on. The songs that people are listening to, that I hear the words and I go, I'm not going to sing that. That's not the word of God. That's doubt and unbelief. That's not truth. And people are just like, singing away. If you only knew, the person that wrote that song smokes dope and does a line or two of cocaine and has no problem with getting drunk. Not just buzzed, not just a wine with dinner. And that's their inspiration. I'm not going to sing a song that's born out of that inspiration. I want to sing a song that's born out of their inspiration of the Holy Ghost. Don't be drunk with wine wherein is debauchery, but be filled with the Holy Ghost. Speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Singing and making melody in your heart unto God. Hey, listen, we're going to have to be more discerning about what's going on. Because I'm telling you right now, what people got going on, they think is the anointing, is just nothing but sensationalism. It's just a slight cut above a kumbaya atmosphere. You know, everybody's singing all at the same time. It's purely human. It's not Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost realm shakes you with the awe of God, a holy fear that causes you to recognize that sin is worthy of death and that God has called us into a communion of purity and holiness with Him. It changes your whole description and understanding of the world around you. And that's why there has to be a revival in the church. There has to be somebody who's going to turn back and let the Holy Ghost take over. I mean, even Billy Graham said that if people could only understand that if the Holy Ghost was not even present on the earth, the majority of churches would still be doing exactly what they're doing. Nothing would have changed because they do it without the Holy Ghost. Why would we do that? When Jesus sent the Holy Ghost to be the very life of the church, as he is the head of it, the Holy Ghost has come to reveal Jesus. How does the Holy Ghost reveal Jesus? Tell me that. He reveals Jesus with signs and wonders and miracles, just as he did through Christ Jesus. And just as Paul said, I have fully preached the gospel from Jerusalem to Illyricum with signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost. So all of these things are the demonstration of heaven. It's the heavenly, it's the spiritual, it's the realm of God, what God the Holy Ghost is doing. It's that which takes the torment that's in people's mind and brings and drives it out and brings them peace. It's that which causes the crippled to walk, the blind to see, the person whose life was wrecked with sin and shame to be suddenly free and accepted in the beloved, to where now they live in God's presence 100% holy and acceptable. Amen. And unfortunately, many people feel unholy and unacceptable. That's antichrist, man. That's anti-God. How are you going to offer your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, when you feel unholy and unacceptable? Well, you need to get born in the Spirit. You need to begin to trust in the blood of Jesus Christ that will cleanse you and wash you from all sin. He'll dress you up in white fine linen that has no stain nor spot. He cleansed the church, you see, with the washing of the water of the word, so they might come for, so they might have a church, rather, without spot. Amen. Without blemish. Which is the Old Testament symbolism of something being tamim, or perfect. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, if we just begin to understand how beautiful this is, we'll get rid of all of the has-tos, and we'll have the want-tos. People talk about legalism. Legalism, I mean, that's the law of Moses. That's the definition of legalism. Or it's salvation by works. Who's talking about salvation by works? We're talking about the works that come as a result of salvation, not the salvation that comes as a result of works. We're not saved by any works of righteousness which we have done, but because of his great love wherewith he loved us. And when we were dead in trespasses and sins, he saved us by the washing of water of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. Amen. That's what the Bible says. Why don't we just go with what the Bible says? I look at people all the time. They can do, you know, multivariable equations and math. They can tell you, you know, what the half reaction is of some obscure physical chemistry problem. They can tell you, you know, what happened 3,000 years ago on February the 10th. I mean, they got all these facts, and they say they know the Lord, but they don't hardly have a verse of Scripture in their spirit. They don't hardly have. They're almost totally lost. They've been studying all those other books and didn't study the only book. They've been studying all those things that really have really very little value and didn't take a hold of that which was spirit and life, that which is powerful and living, that which will make alive on the inside of us the glory of heaven, the realms of faith. And so as a result, people walk by sight instead of by faith. People think that faith is your belief system. It is not. Faith is the working of the Holy Ghost in our lives because we're willing to be obedient to the Word of God. That's what faith is. It's not a belief system. Jesus identified faith in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 8. Matthew chapter 8, verse 10. It's when the centurion said, I don't need you to come to my house. Speak the word only. Jesus said, that's faith. Speak the word only and my servant shall be healed. That's where Jesus identified. Jesus said, that's faith. That sets precedence right there. And that then is built on, because then he talked about faith being able to move mountains with it, being able to say to a sycamore tree, be plucked up and planted in the sea. I mean, faith will ultimately work in complete overthrow of natural laws. It is not hyperboles, Jesus speaking in exaggerative language to make a point. It's God telling us the truth of those things, of the unlimited realm of God. It's what Jehovah said, the Father said when he came to Abraham, sat down with Abraham in Genesis chapter 18. And he says, is there anything too difficult for my word? I know King James translated, King James said, is there anything too hard for me? When he's talking about Sarah being 90 years old, getting ready to have a baby, and Abraham being 100. Huh? And they're laughing. Both of them really are laughing. That's why Isaac was named Isaac, because that's what that means, laughter. And he says, why are you laughing? Why Isaac? You know, he's asking them, Mahisach, why are you laughing? And so he said, okay, you're going to call him laughter. Call him Isaac, okay? Call him laughter. That's what his name would be. Hallelujah. God will make you laugh. His miracles are so, what God do in your life is so extraordinary, he just make you laugh. Amen.
Amen.
He says, King James says, anything too hard for me. Literally, it's this. Is my word too difficult? The best way would be to translate is anything too difficult for my word. What I speak, what comes out of my mouth. I'm just trying to do a literal translation there. It's kind of a little hard to just literally translate word for word, but it's literally, is anything too difficult for my word? What is the answer to that? No, we understand by faith, God framed the heavens by his word. Father wants his word coming out of your mouth. Hallelujah. So what it do? It trains you to speak his word. Hallelujah. He gets you around something more. God, Father, got us around something far more than just an anointed Samuel, an anointed prophet, an anointed Elijah. He got us around the Holy Ghost. So we get to have, not only listen to the Holy Ghost speak, we get to have the Holy Ghost speak through us so that we may be able to accurately speak his word. And so it's very, very important for me to try to emphasize this thing to you real quickly and just, so he says, likewise, except ye utter by the tongue words easy to understand, how shall it be known what is spoken? For you should speak into the air. There he says, because there's many kinds of voices and in the world, but none of them is without signification. Therefore, I know not the meaning of voice. He said, therefore, if I know not the meaning of the voice, I shall be unto them that speaketh a barbarian, and he that speaketh shall be a barbarian unto me. And then listen to what he says. Even so, you forasmuch as you are zealous of the spiritual. And now, what is he talking about? Once again, he's going to emphasize tongues. Okay? Even so, you, forasmuch as you are zealous of the spiritual, seek also that you may excel. So he opens up, follow after love, but be zealous for the spiritual. And the very thing, the next thing he says is, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaks not unto man, but unto God. So we know what he's talking about, don't we? Huh? Hidrabo, the mystery and the spirit. Do you understand that? Does that make sense to everybody who reads? Okay, good. Okay, just checking. Because sometimes I look at books and I go, do you read? I mean, see spot run. Okay, but at any rate, that was my first book that I remember. Okay, so for as much as you're zealous of the spiritual, seek that you may excel under the edifying of the church. So he's telling us, listen, there is an utterance, this language, this tongue, this baptism in the Holy Ghost, this Pentecost, this experience that happened on Pentecost that the prophet Joel prophesied over, this gift of the Father, this promise of the Father, this ministry of Jesus. Yeah, it's wonderful. It's excellent. And he's going to repeat that in a minute. It's glorious. You're speaking to the Father, not men. But I want you to allow that to now excel into something more. Okay? And now he's going to say, look, and the something more is not just the interpretation of tongues.
Right.
Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
The something more is revelation. The something more is knowledge also. The something more is prophecy. The something more is doctrine. Hello. Yeah, because link it back to the prophet Joel and understand how this all works together. And then when you begin, and what my most important point is not to fill you with a bunch of knowledge and information, but help you understand how easy these things are to function in when you just begin to catch the wind of inspiration. When you begin to allow the creativity of God the Holy Ghost, that he would teach us that there's a realm of creativity above anything that anyone is born with. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Parobasekede metayaha. Esetaraneya. Not only builds you up and strengthens you, what does it build you up and strengthen you in and to do? In fact, when you're filled with the Spirit or baptized in the Holy Ghost, because there are synonyms in the New Testament, you become strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might, so you're able to deal with all spiritual wickedness in high places. Ephesians 6, 10 through 12. But what does it do? It stirs up holy emotions so that you can begin to find yourself captivated, caught away in the currents of love and joy and peace.
Amen.
And long-suffering and gentleness and goodness and kindness and meekness. Hallelujah. It teaches you how to be caught away in the inspiration realms of God. How to recognize him in you. How to recognize him with you. Huh? how to function with him, how to move with him, how to think like him. How, you know, people talk about, I hear people talk about being dude with the Lord Jesus Christ or put on the Lord Jesus Christ, but they don't know how to. They have no practical application for that. It's just a mental ascent. They're trying to figure out some kind of ritual, some kind of formula of how am I going to have the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit? How am I going to be put on the Lord Jesus Christ? How am I going to walk in the Spirit? If you're led by the Spirit, you should not fulfill the lust of the flesh. How am I going to do that? And then that's where it really becomes works, because they've not allowed the inspirations of God, hallelujah, to fill them. And that's really my point. I want you to get comfortable with God. I want you to get relaxed. You know, you do your best when you relax. You know, you do. And did you know that the Holy Ghost, one of his names is Comforter? He'll really relax you. He's such a comfort. When you're comforted, you're relaxed. Hallelujah. And now and then about you, and in a mental process, it's this wonderful realm of relationship where the one who lives on the inside of you now can begin to be expressed through you. What a day. And in a radical way that is distinctively demarcated from what you would do normally. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Amen. I pray in Jesus' name that you'll hear. Now hear what Paul says now in light of this. He says, verse 13, wherefore let him that speaks in an unknown tongue pray that he may interpret. Okay? And I want you to understand that he's talking about this place and this disposition of being zealous. Being, you know, I'm asking God for something. I'm asking God for a miracle. Now I'm going to tell you, what happens is this. You're going to find the inspiration realm. And it ain't going to take too much praying. And then once that realm begins to happen in your life, you begin to understand this, what it means to rejoice over evermore and pray without ceasing. And that ain't works. That's a flow. That's a lifestyle. That's having the life of God on the inside of you, and you get to live it. It's called abundant life. It's called the life of the Spirit. It's called the life of Christ. It's called that life that no one can have until they step into that which Father has given. And there'd be a lot of people talking about it, but they're not living it. And I'm telling you about the living faith, the living life. Yeah. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Praise God.
I'm almost done. Hang with me just a few more minutes. I promise you, it will be a blessing to you. Okay, verse 14. So, verse 14. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my what's praying? Spirit's praying. Hallelujah. He says, but my understanding is unfruitful. I don't know what I'm saying. Huh? Right. The knowledge, information area is an important area. I'm talking to it right now. But his spirit knowledge still. He says, what are we going to do then? He said, here's what we're going to do, guys. You ready? Here's what we're going to do then. We're going to pray in the Spirit.
Amen.
What are you doing when you're praying in the Spirit? If you pray in an unknown tongue, what happens? You're... Spirit prays.
Yes.
Is everybody, see spot run. And then people want to go and try to change what Paul said in Corinthians and make it different in Ephesians and make it different in Colossians and make it different in Philippians. That's nonsense. That's wrong. And every theologian who's ever done it knew that they were violating the text. They did it anyways because it was contrary to what they believed. You listening to me?
Yeah.
I'm going to pray in the Spirit, and I'm going to pray with the understanding also. But I want you to understand what Paul is building an argument for is that praying in the understanding is fruitful. It's fruitful because, and it's of the Spirit because it excelled out of praying in the unknown tongue or praying in the Spirit. So now it's just not something that is of human understanding, of a human mind, of a human origin, but now it's heavenly. It's divine insight. It's a glorious realm. It's a prayer of faith. Prayer of faith isn't something that you conjure up because you just now convince yourself that it's true. It's something that the Holy Ghost does through us. In fact, somebody said, how much could this happen in your life? It's supposed to be coming out of you like gushing forth of rivers. Rivers of inspiration. It is the first immeasurable, unlimited gift that you and I receive. And it is the door ministry. It's a doorway in all the other gifts of the Spirit. And not only that, it is the declaration, we call it the ascension gift, because it reveals and declares that Jesus has ascended up on high and has received the promise of the Father and has poured forth that which you see and hear. the proof that he rose from the dead and has exalted and has ascended and became the baptizer in the Holy Ghost and fire, because that's when his heavenly ministry began. Acts 1:5. Acts 1:8 is the last thing he said about it. You should receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, so that you may be my witnesses. Because you can't witness of heaven. Even if you ate with him and lived with him for more than 3 years, even if you had been empowered by him and sent out to raise the dead by him, you still are disqualified. You cannot be a true, accurate, bona fide, legal, heavenly legal witness of who Jesus is and what he's done until you receive this outworking, this expression of the Holy Ghost, because only the Holy Ghost can testify of this supernatural unseen realm that we walk in not by sight but by faith, because we look on the things which are unseen instead of that which is seen. We live by the word of God. Amen. Which produces faith. Yes. Hallelujah. Miraculous realm. We look unto the author that is of our faith, unseen realm. Yes. We interact and operate by the Holy Ghost, unseen realm, but made visible through our bodies, yes. But made visible through our lives, where heaven now becomes earth. Miracles work the same way. Hallelujah. So Wednesday night, there was such a display, a glorious display of the power of God. I was standing right here, and I was translated into another realm. Right here, standing right here. And then I began to prophesy to people. I began to pray for different people. Power of God came like a rushing mighty wind. Eh? Yes. Anybody who was touched by that, you understand.
Yes.
Anybody who got in the middle of that. Somebody might say, oh, well, I didn't really receive that. I wasn't aware of it. Don't worry. You will be. Just stay hungry. Stay thirsty. You're going to get real aware. You won't miss out on a thing God's doing. I'm telling you. And all that came as an outworking of just being willing to cooperate with the Holy Ghost. You're not going to have that kind of outworking in churches that are not going to allow the baptism ministry of Jesus to take place. You're not going to have signs and wonders and miracles in churches that are not going to allow the baptismal ministry of Jesus Christ to take place, which is precedent set and revelation of it is given, Acts chapter 2, over and over again. That is the church. That's what Paul's talking about here. Many years later. What should we do? We're going to pray in the Spirit. That's praying in the Holy Ghost. How many can do that? Well, on the day of Pentecost, they all did it at the same time. As the Holy Ghost gave them utterance, they all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. And all the people heard in their own languages, it was all speaking with those other tongues. Praying in the Spirit. Somebody said, I didn't heard everybody praying in the Spirit. Yeah, we're all talking to God. That's okay. Isn't that okay? There's nobody standing up. See, now, right now, if I just stood here and go, just stood here, Satakarana Jepayala Manjabraboko, Manderesteri Mangaraba Sheprebayala Mambaya. How long are you going to endure? Now, there is a place that I could go. No. Now, there is a place that I could go in that, and you begin to feel the atmosphere change. Sudara, zdedegele mezeberata mafate. Because there is a plarabos taraneatistekanente arnara that has an atmospheric effect. No. What, you don't preach now? Hallelujah. I want you to understand that. You can change the very atmosphere of your life. You can go from sad to glad real quick. You can go from scared to bold real quick. You can go from doubt to full of faith real quick if you know how to hook up with the Holy Ghost. Because he supplies it. People running around trying to get it for themselves, trying to be happy. God said to be happy. I got to be happy. You're going to do that by the arm of flesh. Have you begun in the Spirit to now be very made perfect by human ability? Why don't you learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost? It's much more fun. It is much more effective. Amen. Amen. And so then what else? You weigh a ton. Yes. Okay. So that needs to be interpreted. So what else he say? What else he says? He said, we will sing in the Spirit. He's saying, what are we going to do in church? He's talking about church order. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
He's talking about church order. He says, what are we going to do then? We're going to pray in the Holy Ghost, tongues, the language of the Spirit, that which no man understands, the unknown tongue. And we're going to pray with the understanding also. Amen. We're going to sing. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do you know, you can, there's not a lot of churches that sing in the Spirit. And understand that that is the order of the church. And then we sing in the understanding also. And then that's where the beautiful songs are written. We have those written every church service. Did you know that? Amen.
Amen.
And what has happened? Tongues has excelled into in something that can be understood. And it was an inspiration. And let me just tell you. Are you, is that the way you do it? Huh? Somebody said, well, yeah, I just don't believe that kids can be filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Ghost in the third trimester. Hallelujah. I mean, I just believe anything that the Bible sets precedence for. Hallelujah. Well, that's just a little, people looking after the natural. Her spirit's as big as anybody's spirit in here.
That's right.
You got a little miniature baby spirit. It is, yeah, come on, man. Come on. There's many things that the Lord would teach you, and I can't do it all in one night, but I want you to get this. I just want you to understand. I want you to try to understand this. By the Holy Ghost. I'm not doing that out of my own self. I know how to yield to the Holy Ghost. I know how to yield to Him in the middle of the night when I wake up in the morning. I stay there. I just live here. If this isn't going on, I realize there's something's wrong with me in my walk with God. I want to be led by the Holy Ghost. I want to walk in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And so these are just some of the things that He does. But what can come out of that, I can be so strengthened in that it then just creates inspiration for other things. In other words, I don't begin to speak necessarily out of the inspiration of that tongue. Are you with me? Can you understand what I'm saying? Because I want you to get I want you to get interpretation in tongues tonight, as it's distinct from all those other things that would actually excel out of tongues. Okay? So I can and not receive any direct inspiration from other than I'm strengthened. He that speaks in an unknown tongue, he speaks unto God, but not only does he speak unto God, he strengthens his own self. He builds his own self up. And so now I'm more open to a flow. It like gets me back on point, as it were, if you would. Okay? But then, and you'll see this at times, Elizabeth, for example, will start singing in the Spirit. Huh? And then I'll hear her singing in the Spirit. And I will hear, much lighter model. I will have an inspiration. It will be just an inspiration. Sometimes I will hear a word or a phrase, but other times it's just an inspiration. It wells up in me just like the Stavrabataya. How are you going to pre-think that? Are you with me? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
How are you going to rethink? How are you going to pre-think Stikarana Masutaya? You can't. The same way, so that interpretation of tongues will come, and it comes on the inspiration of the tongue, hearing the tongue. That tongue, it's to be interpreted. And so sometimes you'll hear me stop and I'll be speaking, and it will be a message in tongues, and I will be receiving an inspiration out of that to say something, okay? And that's why I'll say, does anyone have the interpretation? Does anyone know the interpretation? Here's one of the things that's really interesting to me. And then I'm about to close this up, okay? But I just want you to be, I want to fill your heart with these things that you may pray about them, contemplate them. Where I'm now, or someone else is, speaking that is supposed to be interpreted, and everybody else just starts, because they don't have any discernment. They don't recognize the message. They don't know how yet to come under the influence of the inspiration. So in view of that, you need to pray that you may interpret. And I want to make real specific. I want you to pray that you be sensitive to the message in tongues, different from the prayer in tongues. Huh? Because praying in tongues doesn't have to be interpreted. It can just it can just excel to being fruitful with the understanding, which could be in the classification of prophecy, could be in the classification of doctrine, could be in fact classification of revelation. And you could say, well, it's just, or you could say it's just in the classification of praise. You could say that. But praise usually is, by definition in the Bible, an expression of prophecy. Hallelujah. Now, I understand that David taught those in the temple how to praise and give thanks. And he taught them how to praise and give thanks through the songs of prophecy that was given to him. So I understand there's a distinction there, and I want you to make sure that you understand that too. There's nothing wrong with singing songs on the overhead, but you want to be taught how to give thanks and to praise God, how to not do it outside of an encounter with Him, how to not do it outside of flowing in an inspiration in the Holy Ghost and letting the Holy Spirit take that responsiveness, that activity of singing from an overhead or a book, and making it something that goes deeper. But unless you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and with the evidence speaking in tongues, you do not know how to go deeper. You hear me?
Yes.
So I want to just pray. I just want to give you this one last point here in verse 16. He says, else when you bless with the Spirit, else, what is he saying? When you bless with the unknown tongue. Can you see that?
Yes.
I think that many people ought to just go ahead and put that in parentheses because it's already been defined. And I want you to be able to teach this clearly. Else when you bless with the unknown tongue, then how shall the person who occupies the room of the unlearned say amen at your giving of thanks, seeing you, he understandeth not what you're saying. So once again, another emphasis that blessing with the Spirit is in the unknown tongue. All right? Because it can't be understood. Are you with me?
Yes.
Okay. He says this, for you truly give thanks well. Is there anything wrong with that?
No.
For you truly give thanks well when you're praying in the Spirit and when you are singing in the Spirit. But we want everybody else to be edified too. So let it excel and let it come now as the inspiration of that prophecy that Father wants to work through your life. Distinct from the interpretation of tongues, but very similar. An inspiration, but it's an inspiration that is just there in the atmosphere, as it were, okay, in your interaction with the Holy Ghost. Are you with me? Whereas the interpretation of tongues comes as an inspiration from the tongue itself. Hallelujah. So in Jesus' name, I've spoken to you these things tonight by the Spirit of the Lord. I've shown you and proved to you that this is truly indeed the Word of God. And so in every person who's willing to hear, in every person who's willing to receive, I tell you from this day forward and from this moment forward, you're going to begin to understand the interpretation of tongues. And now you're going to begin to understand, even in a deeper way, in a deeper effectiveness, the inspiration that comes to just speak out prophecy, word of knowledge, word of wisdom, to speak out revelation, to speak out the doctrines of God, where all of a sudden, you may not have even realized it, but you're just taking one verse of Scripture after another, and are piecing them together, and you're taking verses of Scripture, as Peter did on the day of Pentecost, and saying, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. We never knew this but before. And now this is not known by anything that men would teach, but it's what the Holy Ghost is declaring right now. And then you can look in the Word and it can be proven. Yep. Peter didn't miss it. He was right on. Because the Messiah actually set up his kingdom 2,000 years ago. He just set it up in a bit different way than everybody perceived. He's already been crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords. 2,000 years ago, he was coronated. His kingdom has begun. You and I have been translated into the kingdom of dear Son. Everybody stand with me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So just receive. I just want everybody to lift your hands towards heaven. And I want you to understand how easy this is. Just receive right now in Jesus' name. Because it's not any more difficult than that. Just receive right now this wonderful workings of the Holy Ghost. This wonderful activity of the blessings of God. It's not any more difficult than tongues. That wonderful expression of the power of the Holy Ghost to work on the inside of us. On the inside of you. Father, give you wisdom. And Father, give you revelation now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, praise God. Woo-hoo! Man, I tell you, it's just, heaven is a wonderful place. And you know, the Lord said by servant Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 11 that to those under the first covenant, he said to them, look, just obey God. Just Father said, just obey me and walk before me and you shall have days of heaven upon earth. How much more now as we get to live in the Spirit who brings heaven to us? Do we get to live in heaven today? Because our citizenship is in heaven. Our conversation is supposed to be in heaven. We're seated in heaven. We can live out this realm of heaven because we've interacted with the Holy Ghost. Don't get stuck in religion when you can have relationship. Don't get confined by all these earthly things when you can live in the heavenly things. Don't try to work so hard and earn it all for yourself when Father will bless you and take good care of you and give it to you freely and provide for you as a son and daughter in his house. Just seek first the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
Find a bunch of people, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. Praise God.